Struck. Hello there, I've been having so much fun playing these old arcade games that I wanted to make a part 3 for this little series. So far I've covered some big popular games like X-Men, The Simpsons, G.I. Joe, and Cadillacs and Dinosaurs, so let's take a look at some other 80s and 90s arcade games that never ended up on the Super Nintendo for one reason or another. And yes, I understand that the majority of these games I'll be talking about here could not have been ported to the SNES in any realistic way. And I don't care, because this is just a really fun thought experiment on what potentially could have been, and it's a convenient excuse to play some old arcade games. We'll start with Bucky O'Hare from Konami. This one did get an NES port that was obviously massively scaled down compared to the arcade original. I mean, it's a completely different game. The arcade Bucky O'Hare, though, is fantastic, with four playable characters and all sorts of creative level design, like this one here where you're falling from the sky shooting anything that moves. It kind of reminds me of the fourth level of Cybernator. This game is based on a comic series that eventually got its own animated TV show that was abruptly cancelled, but the developers of this one based the story here on what would have been the conclusion of the show. So that's a nice touch. Bucky O'Hare is a little unusual to play because it's got that 3D plane you're used to seeing in beat-em-ups, but since each character has a projectile weapon, the game plays more like a run-and-gun. But yeah, this one is a lot of fun and definitely worth checking out. Also from Konami is Mystic Warriors. This one is an arcade exclusive that wastes no time showing off what it's all about. First, you fight this mini-boss where you blow up the buzzsaw section and it doubles back and saws a thing in half. Then you head into a drive-in movie theater blowing up cars as you go, where you see Sunset Riders playing on the screen. That's fantastic. But before you can enjoy that, here comes a gasoline truck careening out of control, blowing up everything before a boss fight. Then the stage after that, you're speeding downhill on skis, taking out enemies. It's so great. Mystic Warriors had great potential to be Konami's answer to stuff like Ninja Gaiden and the Shinobi series, but it stayed in the arcades and it hasn't seen a home console release since. This one is a lot of fun, it's two-player compatible, and it's also got some of the funniest voice acting ever. Another good side-scrolling action platformer is Magician Lord. This one has at least seen a home console release on the Neo Geo, Neo Geo CD, Virtual Console, and PlayStation Network, but it started in the arcades. This one is interesting because there are six different forms you can adopt, everything from a fire-breathing dragon person to Raijin, a guy who can create an electrical field around himself. Some of the backgrounds and settings appear to be inspired by everything from Contra to Castlevania to R-Type or even Splatterhouse. The thing about this one, though, is that it's really hard, a total quarter muncher in its day, but it's still worth playing. If you want more of a beat-em-up, there's Hook, based on the film, and it's four-player compatible, where you can also play as some of the Lost Boys, like Rufio and Thudbutt. It's six levels long, and no, it's not going to compare to stuff like Alien vs. Predator, but it's still a fun playthrough. What makes it stand out is how you can interact with the stage itself, by cutting these ropes and having stuff fall onto enemies. That's always fun. Let's jump on another Konami game with Asterix, based on the comic series Asterix and Obelix, which is huge all across Europe but basically unknown in the US. This one definitely nails the comic style visuals and has some incredible sprite work. The special moves are really fun here as well. My favorite is that if an enemy has been knocked to the ground, you can pick him up and throw him into other enemies and beat the crap out of him some more. That's so great. Man, Konami used to just kill it with these games back then, but this is another one that never saw a home console release. I'm sure there's some licensing issues to be ironed out with a game like this, but still, there is a definite demand out there for this one to be played again. Moving on to fighting games, in the last arcade video I looked at Monster Maulers, and as some of you pointed out, there's a couple other games in the same vein as that one, where you're not fighting other fighters, but gigantic hideous monsters, like you're fighting a boss gauntlet. First there's Red Earth from Capcom, known as Warzod in Japan. There's four different playable characters here, and okay, obviously this one would have no chance in hell to work on a Super Nintendo, but it's fun to imagine. This game has some great ideas for bosses, like this crazy looking guy with multiple arms and swords, or this guy with what appears to be some kind of ceramic drill? Red Earth is a fun, well-executed monster fighting game with some fun ideas behind it. And there's also Oni the Ninja Master, known in the US as Metamokester. Here you fight a monster with a roof on its head and a baby coming out of its chest, some kind of steampunk Frankenstein's monster thing, and a giant mystical floating baby. Sure, okay. There's three playable characters here, but again, this is all about the monster design. It's pretty typical stuff as far as fighting games go, and no, this would not look nearly as good on the Super Nintendo, but it's still a really fun playthrough if you like boss rush fighting games. I always gotta throw at least one shoot 'em up in these videos, and this time it's Dragon Breed. In this one, you're a kid riding a huge fire-breathing dragon. How can you beat that? This is a really fun one from Irem, the same people behind the R-Type series. You can use the dragon itself as a shield, or use its tail as a whipping attack. Or you can just ignore all nuance and strategy and just kill everything with fire. That works too. This is one that I think could've at least worked on the Sega Genesis. Next, I want to take a look at a unique experiment Capcom put together in 1991. It's called Three Wonders. It's three completely different games shared on one CPS1 board. There's Midnight Wanderers, Quest for the Chariot, a side-scrolling run-and-gun game. There's Chariot Adventure Through the Sky, a horizontal shoot-em-up. And there's Don't Pull, a top-down puzzle game where you push blocks around to crush monsters. In reality, this comes across as more of a tech demo than anything else. It's pretty damned impressive to have three totally different games on the same board. The best of the bunch is easily Midnight Wanderers. The game looks incredible and has a Metal Slug vibe going for it. The boss design is especially well done, and it's especially challenging from beginning to end. Chariot is pretty standard. It's not bad, but nothing about it really stands out. The best way I can describe it is that it's a bit similar to something out of the Cotton series, only with a little bit of a darker edge. Those two games fit together pretty well in terms of theme and presentation, but Don't Pull is just out of left field. It's a decent enough puzzle game, but I'm not sure why it's in this collection. Still, this was an interesting experiment from Capcom, and all three games are worth checking out. This collection got all sorts of home console releases on Saturn, PlayStation, PS2, PS3, and PSP. Finally, there's the real Ghostbusters. It can't be overstated how gigantic the Ghostbusters were back in the 80s. It spawned a huge line of action figures, trading cards, and a Saturday morning cartoon, which this game is based off of. Kind of. If you're curious, the quote-unquote real was added to the title after a copyright dispute. Thankfully, this game has nothing to do with the terrible NES Ghostbusters game. This one is made by Data East, who reskinned a game called Make You Hunter G and put the Ghostbusters license on it. Hey, whatever works. This is still a pretty good game. Nothing all that unique here in terms of gameplay, just a fun top-down 8-way shooter in the same vein as something like Smash TV, just with scrolling levels instead of rooms. And I mean, you're zapping and collecting ghosts, getting power-ups. It's a pretty fun and simple playthrough. Alright, that's all for now. I want to thank you for watching, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.